Hi friends, how are you? I hope you can hear me. Huh? Hi friends. I hope you can hear me. Can I have that heads up from you? Am I audible? Hi Swapna ma'am. Am I audible? So today I'm going to begin this particular heritage talk or a virtual heritage walk on Gurudwaras of Delhi. Just let me know if I'm audible to you. So I basically want to tell everyone over here that although here I'm going to talk about the three Gurudwaras over here, which is Seesganj, Rakabganj Sahib and Bangla Sahib. This doesn't mean there are not other Gurudwaras of importance. Actually, there were seven historical Gurudwaras which were built by Baba Baghel Singh. But due to paucity of time, we are going to cover the three as I mentioned. And here I want to take a little time to just keep in mind about the pain and suffering all around us. And I thought that this topic, this particular topic, and the life of the Sikhs and the teachings of the Sikhs are going to give us a lot of courage, hope, and strength. And which is why I will start with I will quote a line from Gurbani which says, Tati vav na lagai, par brahm sarnai. This means that may the hot winds not touch me, the hot winds cannot touch me because the divine is my protector, because I am in the protection of the divine. So on that auspicious note, I would like to make a beginning for this particular heritage talk. And the story begins from Guru Nanak Ji, who in 1469 he was born. And Guru Nanak Ji was the first Sikh guru, and he was a messenger of peace, harmony, brotherhood and love. And according to him, the three cardinal principles were Kirat Karo, which meant do honest hard work, Naam Japo, which meant keeping the thought of the God in mind, and finally Vand Chakho, by which he wanted to all of us to be altruistic, to be giving, to be sharing what we earn with the poor and the needy. So those were his teachings, and he also believed in the concept of Sacha Sauda. It's very interesting that when he was just 12 years old, his father gave him some money, some 20 rupees, to go and do some business and to earn and get something back at the end of the day. And such was the piousness of Guru Nanak Ji's heart that when he went out with that money to do something, he saw a lot of poor sadhus, and they were hungry too. So he spent all those 20 rupees on feeding those sadhus, and he came home very satisfied and happy, expecting that he will be praised by his father. But his father admonished him, saying, "Oh, you wasted my money." But Guru Nanak Ji's elder sister Nanki came to his defense, and she said that what he did was right. And that why I'm telling you the story is because from this is the genesis of the langar system in Sikhism, where free community kitchens are run for everyone, and everyone can come and have simple but extremely clean food and free of cost. And even in the present times, we have seen that during the COVID crisis, Gurudwaras across the world have opened their kitchens in spite of huge risk to themselves of the infection. They have fed the poor and the hungry, and they continue to do so even as we speak, and they are setting a beautiful example. So that was started by this Sacha Sauda concept, started by Guru Nanak Ji. So friends, Sikhism begins as a very pacifist, very peaceful religion, and the first five gurus in fact were very pacifist, and they had a very shall I say peaceful approach towards life. And the watershed moment came when the fifth guru, Guru Arjan Dev, he was first tortured and then given lots of blandishments. And Mia Mir, the famous Sufi saint of Lahore, who was very close to Guru Arjan Dev Ji, he interceded and he sort of got his death penalty commuted to just heavy fines. But the Guruji refused to pay even those fines because he thought that Jahangir was just being an oppressor. He was oppressing people, he was oppressing the gurus, and he refused any money being taken from anyone for his release. And he was tortured and soon he was martyred. Now Arjun Dev Ji is very very critical over here because he compiled the Adi Granth, the first holy book of the Sikhs, which was the precursor to the Guru Granth Sahib, which was compiled by Guru Gobind Singh Ji. So Arjan Dev Ji also built the beautiful Harmandir Sahib or the Golden Temple in Amritsar, and such was his tolerant nature that Mia Mir, the famous Sufi saint of Lahore, laid the foundation stone of. So that shows us that the tolerant worldview of the Sikh gurus. So when Arjan Dev was executed, he was tortured and he died. He was the first to be martyred among the Sikh gurus. At that time, his son, Guru Hargobind, decided to militarize the Sikhs, and he decided to don the two twin swords of Miri and Piri, where the two swords symbolized Miri means the temporal or the worldly duties the person has to carry out, and the Piri is the spiritual obligations of an individual. So both have connotations in temporal and spiritual context. And from Guru Hargobind Ji onwards, the militarization, the militant, the Sikh gurus became sort of they picked up arms. So this genesis, this background is necessary for you to understand that because there was oppression all around, and gurus were being tortured, and so they took up arms for their self-defense. It has to be understood. Nobody was an enemy of Islam. In fact, all these examples show us that they never had any problem. They only had problems with forced conversions. For them, it was very important for them to have this freedom of following one's faith and the choice and other things. That brings us to this thing that Guru Tegh Bahadur, the ninth guru. So we'll start with the Sis Ganj Gurudwara in a little bit. Before that, let me explain. Guru Tegh Bahadur was the ninth guru, and he was at Anandpur Sahib, and the Kashmiri Pandits who were being persecuted by the Kashmir governor Iftikhar Khan, and they were being forcefully converted, they rushed to Guruji, Guru Tegh Bahadur at Anandpur Sahib, asking for his help because they thought that he has this army and he's a protector of the oppressed. So let us approach him. And that's when Guruji came into this picture, where Aurangzeb, and through his governor of Kashmir, was tormenting the pandits over there. And he said that you go and tell the governor that if you can convert me, I am your guru, if you can convert me to Islam, then all of you can get converted. So this thing really enraged Aurangzeb, and he had the guru captured. So the present day site of Gurudwara Sis Ganj Sahib is where the original Kotwali or the police station used to be. So there the Guruji was kept for many months. He was tortured, and then he was finally, he refused to convert, and his devotees, his followers were also tortured to make the Guru change his mind. But he was adamant that I will not change my faith because I have already accepted Waheguru as my Lord. Then so that's where he was beheaded. And so let's just see the picture over here. So this is the Gurudwara Sis Ganj Sahib. It's in Chandni Chowk area of Delhi. And Chandni Chowk is, if you have been there, you would see that it is right opposite the Red Fort, which is the seat of Mughal Emperor. And yeah, so this is the Sis Ganj Sahib Gurudwara. And as you can see, there's the beautiful Nishan Sahib, that iron staff carrying that flag of the Khalsa is also there. This is how the Gurudwara looks from inside. So this is the view towards the Singhasan. That beautiful golden canopy is the Singhasan where the Guru Granth Sahib is kept. And it is one of the holiest shrines of Sikhism. Because just under this Singhasan is the place where the Guruji was beheaded because he refused to convert to Islam, and he was upholding the rights of the Kashmiri Hindus. Okay, so this is from the other angle of the same Singhasan. Look at the beautiful carving. It's a gilded canopy, and it is beautifully carved, and the Gurbani is read throughout the day over here. And now we will go just under this thing. Yeah, this is another view. Okay, so friends, this is the place which is the Shahidi Sthal of Shri Guru Tegh Bahadur Ji. And this is the place where the Jallad, executed him by beheading him because he refused. As you can see over here, that that's weapons are also being revered. And this is another much more beautiful view, much more closer view. That is Guru Tegh Bahadur Sahib. That is Guru Tegh Bahadur Sahib, and it's beautifully gilded, and the weapons are also there, which are being revered. We will later on also understand the significance of these weapons and what each weapon stands for towards the other part of the talk. And so this is a beautiful side view of the Singhasan where the Guru Granth Sahib is being kept, and throughout it's being chanted. Okay, I want to draw your attention to this picture. This is where the langar happens, this is actually the place when the old Kotwali, the police station at the time of the Mughals, used to be there. This was the place of the jail where the Guru Sahib was kept and tortured for months. And if you can see this picture, this is where Bhai Jaita, so when he was executed and beheaded, Bhai Jaita And there was a big storm, and there was a melee, and there was a huge confusion and commotion at the beheading of the guru, and the whole city was outraged, and even the guards were taken off guard. In that melee and confusion, Bhai Jeta wrapped his head very respectfully and rushed away from this place and went to Anandpur Sahib, where this picture conveys that meeting of Bhai Jeta, and he's presenting the head to his son, Guru Gobind Singh, when he was a little child. And the lady behind Guru Gobind Singh is Mata Gujri, wife of Guru Tegh Bahadur Ji. This is a very poignant moment, and so this is where the langar happens. And in fact, I also partook of this blessed food, and it was wonderful, simple, clean, and very, very. It's a beautiful, magnetic atmosphere over there. One should experience it at least once in a lifetime. Here I wanted to also tell you about the langar and why it is important. So the Sacha Sauda concept of Guru Nanak, which started, that laid the foundation of Dasvand also. So Dasvand is where you give 10% of your earnings towards charity, to feed the poor via langar or for any other donation, any way that you can help the poor and the needy. It is said that लो लंगर तपदी राही. So लो लंगर तपदी राही is a पंजाबी, it's a thing, which is said in their religion, that may the pots be ever warm. So that means लो लंगर तपदी राही, that's important. Even the last guru Gobind Singh Ji, he famously said that देख 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 Teg di Fateh. So Teg means the food, the service angle, and the Teg. Teg is the sword. So may the service and the sword be living forever. Teg de di Fateh. And he also said that Teg Teg Dou Chalai. So Teg Teg Jag Dou Chalai. That was what he said, and which means that in the world, let the service as per the langar, as per the donation to the poor, and the sword, the protector of the poor, may ever be victorious, and they may ever be existing. So right from Guru Nanak, the first guru, to the last 10th Guru Gobind Singh Ji, they had a big emphasis on langar and its importance. By the way, I also visited the langar of Bangla Sahib, and I happened to see a wonderful sight that when the food is cooked, it is ardas, and the holy scriptures are being read, and it's a very, very holy atmosphere. Once the food is cooked, it is offered to the Guru Granth Sahib. First thing, the bhog is given to, the offering is given to Guru Granth Sahib, and the kirpan is run through every food item. So that it's felt that the food gets blessed, and then the food is given to the Sangat. So it's very important. So the concept of langar is extremely critical, because it is like everyone sits in a row. It's called Pangat. So Pangat is when everyone sits in a row. You might be high and mighty, rich or whoever, and if you are poor, it doesn't matter. You are same in the eyes of the guru, so you have to sit in the same queue, in the same line. So that's called Pangat. And in fact, Amar Das Ji, the guru, also said very famously that pehle Pangat, pache Sangat. So such was his importance, and given by them, that first you have to feed yourself. So feed everyone. Let that be, the food should be, the stomach should be full, and then the Sangat, the holy congregation, can happen. Everything comes later. First, feed the poor, feed everyone. So, this was something that I thought I should share. Then, So, this is something very interesting I want to show you. This is called the Hukumnama. This is the Hukumnama of the day that I visited Shishganj Sahib. And Hukumnama is nothing but a random holy hymn which comes on the left page. So every day the Guru Granth Sahib is opened in the and on the left page any random hymn is picked up, and that is considered as if the God, the hukum or the order is coming from the God himself to be put in a public place, so that it's an order from the God to everyone, all the devotees coming to the Gurudwara that day. So this is what the Hukumnama looks like, and this is it's a beautiful concept, and I thought that this was relevant. Okay, so here we come to the entrance of Rakabganj Sahib Gurudwara, and okay, so before that, I wanted to say when Guru Sahib was executed, beheaded at Sisgan Sahib, his head was taken by Bhai Jeta to Anandpur Sahib, while his body was, in that confusion and chaos, Lakhi Shah Vanjara, another devotee of Baba, took his body, hid it inside his cotton. He was carrying cotton. He was a cotton seller, so he hid his body in the bales of cotton and on a cart driven by a bullock or something, and then he rushed away from there so as to avoid further sacrilege or insult to his dead body. And he took it to this place near Raisina Hill, the current Raisina Hill, where the seat of the country, the government, is there. So Gurudwara Rakabganj Sahib is located at the base of the Raisina Hill, and Lakhi Shah Vanjara took his body there, and since the Mughals were monitoring, Aurangzeb soldiers were patrolling everywhere, so very, very cautiously he navigated this entire area and reached that place, hiding his body under the bales of cotton, and his village was there at Rakabganj Sahib site. And a public funeral would not have been possible for the guru because of obvious reasons. So what he did is that he took the body and he placed his body inside his house, and he set his house on fire. So he had a wooden house and he set his house on fire, and that's how a respectful cremation was given to Guru Sahab. And so such was the devotion that a poor man burnt his own house so just so that the guru can have a decent, respectful, cremation. And so that site is Rakabganj Sahib. So let's see that. So this is the entrance gate of Rakabganj Sahib. It is just opposite the museum of the secretary, I think the Lok Sabha Museum or something. Very close to the president's estate. Yeah, so this is a beautiful evening picture of Rakabganj Sahib, and this giant Nishan Sahib, that flagstaff in the foreground, and another one at the back with that beautiful triangular shaped flag fluttering. We'll come to the Nishan Sahib and its significance in a bit. This is another view of Rakabganj Sahib Gurudwara. Okay, so I specially wanted to capture this image of Nishan Sahib because I think it's very important to explain the significance of this symbol. So Nishan Sahib is very important in Sikh religion. So Nishan, as the name suggests, it's a symbol. It's a symbol of the presence of a Gurudwara in a locality. So at that time there was no GPS. People would not know where a Gurudwara is located. So a Nishan Sahib, this iron flagstaff, shows the location of a Gurudwara to people coming from far away who would not know where the location is. And this is also an indicator that God is there. God is near you. He's not far away, and you are protected at all times. So it is always in saffron color. It's a triangular It's a triangular flag, saffron in color, which is the color of valor and bravery. Right in the middle is the Sikh emblem, which has a khanda and a chakkar and two kirpans on either side. We're going to see the significance of that symbol a little later. And on top of this Nishan Sahib is always a khanda. So a steel khanda is at the top of Nishan Sahib. And so this is almost like a presence of God amidst you. Yeah, I also wanted to show you this beautiful silver filigree work done on the doors of Rakabganj Sahib. I think this is really, really beautiful. So I thought it was worth capturing for everyone. Okay, so this is how Rakabganj Sahib looks like from inside. This is where the Singhasan is, where Guru Granth Sahib is being read throughout the day. As you can see, there are three Granthis or the priests over there who are singing Gurbani. And yeah, so here I would like to just share with you that Guru Granth Sahib, so right in the morning, so Guru Granth Sahib is considered almost like a living, so not almost, it is considered a living guru. And so he retires at night to that room in the corner. We are going to have a closer look. So it's called Sukhasan. He retires at night to that room. And every early morning, he is again brought back to the Singhasan. This is the Singhasan. That room in the corner is the Sukhasan. So, and right in the morning, Sukhmani Sahab, hymns from the Sukhmani Sahab are read. Which was composed by Arjan Devji, and that is really early in the morning. Then a little later, around 6 or 7, Asadiwar is also recited, which is again composed by Guru Arjan Devji. And towards the evening, Rehsar Sahib is recited. And this is such a beautiful picture. I wanted to capture it because it clearly shows the finely decorated and gilded canopy of the Singhasan where the holy Guru Granth Sahib is being read. And this man is here in all the devotion. And right under this canopy, as you can see that portion, that is where the cremation of the body of Guru Sahib, Guru Tegh Bahadur Sahib was carried out by Lucky Shah Vanjara by burning his own house. Yeah, so this is the underground room where Babaji's photo is there, Guru Tegh Bahadur Ji's photo is there, and this is where his body was cremated. I also captured this beautiful inlay work on marble. Yeah. Okay, so this is the room which is called the Sukhasan. This is where the Guru Granth Sahib, who is considered a living guru, he retires at night. And this is where he's rested, and every early morning to the chants of Sukhmani Sahib, he is brought out again and placed on the Sukhasan, on the Singhasan, the canopy. And before that, it is cleaned and wiped, and seva is done and all of that. And throughout the day, through the chants of Asadiwar, Sukhmani Sahib and Rehsar Sahib, he is venerated by thousands and lakhs of people. Okay, here I would like to tell you that now we will go and talk about the third Gurudwara, and the third Gurudwara over here we are going to talk about is Bangla Sahib Gurudwara. Now Bangla Sahib Gurudwara has a very, very special place in the hearts of Sikhs and others also, because it is associated by the child guru, Guru Harkishan ji. It is amazing that a child of 5 years, he was just 5 years old when he was anointed the guru, and by eight he had left this world. By 8 years he had left this world, and so this house, Bangla Sahib, the current place of Bangla Sahib, the location, this used to be the bungalow or the bungla of Mirza Raja Jai Singh, Savai Jai Singh, Mirza Raja Jai Singh of Jaipur. And Mirza Raja Jai Singh of Jaipur's palace was here, and he was the army commander of Aurangzeb. So, in fact, Aurangzeb used his services to forcibly get Harkishan ji to come to stay with him in this house and to Delhi, and he wanted to, you know, sort of keep a check on him, because he was extremely popular, very very popular, had a loyal following in Punjab, in the entire north of India, and he, Aurangzeb, was really insecure with all this popularity and people, you know, going after this child guru, Guru Harkishan ji. So to keep him in check, he was brought to Delhi and asked to stay with Mirza Raja Jai Singh in his palace, this current location of Bangla Sahib. And what is interesting about this place is that at that time there was this epidemic of chechak going on in Delhi. Chechak is smallpox. So epidemic of cholera and chechak, the smallpox, was there throughout Delhi, and people were dying in the thousands. At that time, this Guruji came, this little Guruji came, and he sort of came and blessed this sarovar, which was there at that time also, next to this Gurudwara, which we're going to see in a bit. And people miraculously got cured from this healing touch, that when he dipped his feet in the sarovar, that water healed all these people miraculously. So instead of his following reducing, he became even more popular, so therefore infuriating Aurangzeb even more. We'll just go and have a look at the pictures of Bangla Sahib, and we'll continue the talk thereafter. Yeah. So this is one of the beautiful, you know, entrances to Bangla Sahib. And Bangla Sahib Gurudwara is beautifully framed in this arch, this scalloped arch with all the beautiful filigree work over there. So this is one view. And this is another view from the other side of Bangla Sahib, from the Baghel Singh Museum side. So this museum is in the name of Baba Baghel Singh. We are going to talk about him in a bit. Yeah. So at night it looks gorgeous, so I thought of capturing some images from the night also. It is beautifully decorated, and it's a sight to behold at night. It is beautifully decorated. I also thought that let me go on the other side of the sarovar and click few pictures from there, because this beautifully, it has a reflection, lovely reflection in the sarovar, and the Nishan Sahib, the tall flag post, and if you can just check out the moon is also visible. So this was late evening, and it is such a peaceful sight. People in the thousands come and sit here, and they just gaze at the Gurudwara from here, and they get a lot of peace and solace when they come here. And in such a time as we are in right now, where we need solace, peace and courage, these sites, I'm sure, are going to give you lots of comfort. Okay, so this is the picture which I had posted when I was announcing the walk. So this is from the other side, at an angle. So here the Gurudwara is in one corner, while at an angle the entire sarovar is visible. And there are beautiful fishes, by the way, and people come and take bath over here, and they think that Guruji is blessing him or her when they do that. Yeah, this is the entrance of the beautiful Gurudwara Bangla Sahib. As I have already told you, it acquires its name Bangla because it used to be the earlier residence, Bangla of Mirza Raja Jai Singh of Jaipur, Army Commander Aurangzeb. Yeah, so this is the Singhasan of Bangla Sahib Gurudwara. Singhasan is this beautiful gilded canopy which in under which Guru Granth Sahib is revered. And so these granthis are reading, these priests are chanting beautiful hymns, and while everyone is just spellbound listening to this kirtan happening. Yeah, so these, even the pillars and everything is gilded over here, not just the singhasan. So this is much more decorated, much more richly decorated. Of all gurudwaras, this is the most richly decorated. As you can see, a lot of people are lost. They're just spellbound in this captivating atmosphere, filled with gurbani and devotional music. Yeah. So now we will go and have a look at the Baghel Singh Museum, which is just at the entrance of Bangla Sahib Gurudwara. So when the COVID times go away and the better times come back, I would suggest every one of you should head to this Gurudwara and please check out this museum. It is a treasure trove about Sikh history and tradition. So we'll dive right into that and have a look at the things. Okay, so this is the emblem or the insignia of the Sikhs. Right in the middle is the khanda. The khanda is this double-edged sword, and it is the sword is it is almost like it is symbolic of the god. So it is like a personification of God for them. So if you have noticed, even the Nishan Sahib is topped by the khanda. And so the khanda, around the khanda is this thing called chakkar. So chakkar is another weapon. So these are the four weapons holy to the Sikhs, and this emblem contains all four. So chakkar is representative, or it symbolizes God himself. So chakkar is just like a circle doesn't have a beginning or the end. The Sikhs believe that even the God, in fact Guru Nanak ji himself said, "Ek Onkar," there is only one God. So this chakkar is representing that one God who's timeless, formless, eternal, no beginning, no end, just like this circular weapon. It is a very sharp weapon, and in fact the Nihangs, or the militant section of Sikhs raised by Guru Gobind Singh, they always wear it on their turbans. And in fact Baba Deep Singh, who we are going to talk about a little later, he always wore it on his turban, and most Sikhs wear it on the turban, the militant Sikhs, and it is a very, very handy weapon at all times. So this khanda and chakkar are framed by these two curved swords. They are called the Miri and Piri swords. So as I was telling you earlier, that Guru Hargobind, the son of Guru Arjan Dev Ji, when Arjan Dev Ji was tortured by Jahangir and he died, that's when the pacifist Sikhism came to an end, and the Guru Hargobind, his son, picked up arms in self-defense and in protection of the poor and the oppressed. Please remember, he did not pick up arms, and Sikhism did not pick up arms to attack or to be the aggressor. The Sikhism only picked up arms to protect the needy and the oppressed. So they thought that while we are peaceful, this does not mean that we can be killed at will, or we can be converted at will. So that is why the arms were picked up. So Miri and Piri are again, they represent the temporal or the worldly obligations. Miri and Piri, as the name suggests, from Pir, it has spiritual obligations. So a Sikh has both obligations. You have to stay in this world, do as best as you can, be practical, and also be spiritual at the same time. So not to forget both. So this is very critical. This is
is the symbol, and this is actually the symbol of the Sikhs is always on the Nishan Sahib, the flagstaff outside every Gurudwara. The flagstaff with the saffron flag, I mean to say. Okay. Okay, so this is a beautiful artwork of this benevolent looking lady feeding all these poor people, and of all religions, there's a Muslim, there's a Hindu, there are several people sitting here. So this is Mata Khivi. So Mata Khivi has a very significant position in Sikh history, and she was the wife of Guru Angad, and this lady has the distinction of being the only woman, as in the only wife of a guru, to be mentioned by name in the Guru Granth Sahib. No other wife of any guru is mentioned in the Guru Granth Sahib, only Mata Khivi. In fact, she was so hospitable and loving and to the poor and the needy, she used to feed everyone, there was a time the langar was called Khivi ka langar. So she became synonymous with langar itself. Okay, here we come to this warrior, this fierce looking warrior. He's Baba Deep Singh. Everyone in Sikhism knows him, and he is a very valiant figure. And Baba Deep Singh, Ahmad Shah Abdali, so let me just explain. Ahmad Shah Abdali attacked India almost 9 times during that time, and one of the times he attacked and destroyed Harmandir Sahib or the Golden Temple. So Baba Deep Singh, when he was going to attack Amritsar, when Abdali was going to attack Amritsar, Baba Deep Singh attacked or tried to prevent him from looting Amritsar and attacking Harmandir Sahib. And he was from the Shahidan missile, and he was a great warrior, and he really, really gave a tough fight. It is said that his head was also severed, and he held his head in his hand, and he still fought, basically trying to say that he was a great warrior, and he fought outside his skin to, you know, save the Sikh religion and faith and the poor and the oppressed. So these are his soldiers, and this is Baba Deep Singh. Yeah. Okay, this is a very nice painting of Guru Hargobind Singh, and here Guru Hargobind Singh, as you can see, is coming out of Gwalior Fort, and this event is called the Bandi Chhod Diwas. So Guru Hargobind Singh was captured and imprisoned in Gwalior Fort by Jahangir, and because he was annoyed with the ways of the gurus in any case, he tortured Arjan Devji also. And he's coming out on the insistence of Mia Mir, that famous Lahore Sufi saint. Mia Mir told Jahangir that Guru is so popular, don't let the people go against you, please release him, and he's such a pious man. And so he was released. So, but then he refused. Guruji refused, I'm not going to come out until and unless all these 52 other kings who are coming behind him are also released. So such was his selflessness that he wanted to be released only when these 52 kings of North India were released with him. And so therefore, then on this condition he came out, and it's called the Bandi Chhod Diwas. In fact, it coincides with Diwali, and all the Sikhs celebrate lots of pomp and show this happy moment which coincides with Diwali, Bandi Chhod Diwas. So he was like the liberator, Bandi Chhod, liberator of the captured. This is a very, very interesting artifact. So this is not the original. This is actually a copy of the throne of Maharaja Ranjit Singh, and I thought that this should be shown. So this is the throne of Ranjit Singh Ji, and Ranjit Singh Ji, as you know, is called the Sher-e-Punjab, the Lion of Punjab, who laid the foundation of the first Sikh state in the country. And he united the warring missiles. Missiles were basically these armed bands. 12 missiles were there. He united all these warring missiles, and he started the Sikh Confederacy, and Lahore was the capital. And there at the background you can see the procession and the coronation of Ranjit Singh Ji. And Okay. So this is a painting from the same museum. So in 1783, Baba Baghel Singh, Jassa Singh Ahluwalia, Jassa Singh Ramgarhia, and two others, these Sikh misaldars or jathedars attacked Delhi, and at that time Shah Alam II was the emperor. So it is said that Tees Hazari, the court where it is now located, is the place where 30,000 Sikh soldiers had camped. That's how the name got its, it got the place got its name, Tees Hazari. And the Shah Alam's position was in, so Shah Alam's position was very pitiable. They said his reign was only from Red Fort to Palam, and it was in terrible shape. And at that moment, these all these people, all the Sikhs attacked, and led by Baghel Singh, Baba Baghel Singh. And so Shah Alam did not know what to do. He was in a bad shape as such. So Zebun Nisa, Farzana Zebun Nisa, or Begum Samru was the negotiator, or the person who was negotiating on behalf of the Mughal king Shah Alam II with the Sikhs, led by Baba Baghel Singh. And crafty as she was, extremely diplomatic that she was, she got a very good deal for Shah Alam, where the Sikhs agreed not to, capture Delhi forever, but only till the time seven gurudwaras associated with the seven holy sites of the Sikhs were built. Only till that time the Sikhs were going to camp at Tees Hazari. And also they were given huge ransom to not, kill the king, and to buy the king's life, and to, not let the Sikhs capture the Red Fort. Although the Sikhs entered the Red Fort at will, and that picture shows that. Also, the Sikhs got a percentage of the octroi, or the revenue, almost like 6 paisa in 1 rupee, as per the conditions of this treaty. So Farzana, or Begum Samru, saved the day for the king again. And in 8 months, these seven gurudwaras were built by Baba Baghel Singh. That's why his name is extremely, extremely important in Sikh religious history, and for his valor and bravery also. So after that, the Sikhs went back to their dominion in Punjab. And so this shows that the king is beseeching the five misaldars, led by Jassa Singh Ahluwalia, is in the center. So Jassa Singh Ahluwalia was the head of Dal Khalsa. So Dal Khalsa was this confederation of the 12 missiles, and Jassa Singh Ahluwalia was the leader of that. He in fact also got the Golden Temple rebuilt after Abdali ransacked it. And he was the jathedar of the Ahluwalia missile. And in the corner you can see this lady in white. She is Begum Samru, who acted as the negotiator who saved the life of the king from the Sikhs. And okay. And here is a picture of Chamkaur ki ladai. So this is where 46 fought with a huge army consisting of thousands of Mughal soldiers. And here the elder two Sahibzadas of Guru Gobind Singh Ji were martyred. And so this is very, very critical in Sikh history. And the older two were martyred here, while the younger two were first kept in the Thanda Burj of Sirhind by the governor of Sindh, Wazir Khan, and they were tortured in the cold along with their grandmother, Mata Gujri, who was protecting and shielding these little, the two Sahibzadas of Baba, of Gobind Singh Ji.
And after a few days, even these two were, they were put into the walls and they were just walled over. They were, so it's very sad that Wazir Khan, was responsible for the death of the younger two Sahibzadas. And this brings me to the end of it. And I cannot end this without mentioning Guru Gobind Singh Ji, because he was the last Guru, and with him, the parampara or the legacy of Guru stopped, as in the in person, in physical form, as a human being, it stopped. And he said that after me, only the Guru Granth Sahib is going to be the Guru of the Sikhs the world over. And although he also composed the Dasam Granth, but Guru Granth Sahib remains the book which everyone is, it considers holy. And the Mughals even did not leave Guru Granth Sahib, who went all the way to Nanded. He was assassinated in Nanded, and that's where he breathed his last. But he sent Banda Bahadur. He sent Banda Bahadur, one of Rajput, Minhas Rajput converts Lachman Das, Madho Das, who was later on rechristened as Banda Bahadur, as in he was just he was given a baptism. So baptism by stirring a pot of sweetened water with a khanda. So this was called the Amrit Sanchar ceremony, and so that's how he was baptized. And he came back to Delhi, and he avenged the death of the Sahibzadas by killing Wazir Khan, the governor of Sirhind. And he also annexed a couple of states and laid the foundation of the first Sikh state, sort of first Sikh state. And unfortunately, Banda Bahadur was executed in Mehrauli, and there's a Gurudwara which is erected at Mehrauli in his name. And so that's where we end. Thanks for your time, and I hope this leads to this talk gives all of us lots of hope and inspiration and strength. And so let me just see if you have any comments or any questions, just let me know. Swapna ma'am, Bangla Sahib Gurudwara Sarovar is so beautiful, and it's a sight to behold. It gives you a lot of peace and comfort. And so that is it, and that's where I end. And I'll repeat the Gurbani, the line from Gurbani with which I started. Tati vav na lagai, par brahm sarnai. May the hot winds cannot touch me, because the divine is my protector. The divine will save me. So we have hope. So don't lose hope, guys. This too shall pass. Thank you very much.